A very good evening to all of you. I welcome you all to the ICAN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. We will start the day with the first topic. The first topic is related to climate change. So climate change and the changes in the flora, fauna, the ice caps, etc. comes under your GS1 syllabus also, and climate change as a part of your environment comes under your GS3 syllabus as well. So climate change per se is a very important topic that spans across the year GS papers. So this whole editorial was around one recent news, which is about the United Nations Secretary General. He said about India that India must aim to reduce its coal-based emissions by 45% by 2030. So based on this one comment of United Nations Secretary General, this editorial has been written critically analyzing how this statement by the Secretary General may lead to kind of deindustrialization of India, where it is not possible for a developing country like India, which is yet to develop and yet to industrialize, it is not possible for such a developing country to reduce the coal-based emissions by 45% by 2030. So on this, the editorial goes on analyzing. So let's now start with this analysis. The first issue is related to the annual emissions. So when we talk of the annual emissions of each country, then we see that the India's annual emissions are much lower compared to the annual emissions of countries like United States, China, and even Europe for that matter. So that is what this says, that annual emissions, the global average of emissions is nearly 1.3 tons. So it is 1.3 tons per capita is the global average of the annual emissions. But on the other hand, India's emission is just 0.5 tons per capita. So you can see that India's per capita annual emissions is already much, much lower than the global average. And if we talk of countries like China, US and Europe, their average annual emission is much higher than this global average of 1.3 tons. So therefore, India is already emitting very little and contributing very little to the global average emissions. So if it is asked to reduce even further, that may lead to deindustrialization. A much more important concept is a cumulative emission. That is, how much does one country cumulatively emit at the end of 1 year? So when we talk of the cumulative emissions also, India has a population of 1.3 billion, but however, its contribution of cumulative emissions is 4%. But however, contrast this with Europe. Europe has a population of nearly 500 million, but its contribution to the global cumulative emission is 20%. So therefore, even if you compare it with a huge population of India, India's cumulative contribution in comparison to its huge population is also just 4% of the global cumulative contribution of all the countries. So this shows that our emissions are already low, and further lowering, cutting down the emission could endanger our development and industrialization. So this is the first issue. The second is, what is the role of the developed countries? The whole premise of climate change, the basis of the climate change and the nations coming together to act against the climate change is based on the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities, which means the global north, which are the developed countries, they have been emitting a lot more than the middle and the lower income countries. And that is precisely the reason why these countries are developed today. So the developed countries, because they have emitted much more than the developing countries, it is their greater responsibility of the developed countries to act more stringently against this climate change. But however, if you look at the performance of the developed countries, you will see that even these developed countries have not been able to reduce their dependence on coal drastically in all these years. So climate change as a concept has been there for quite some time, and there has been pressure on the developed countries to reduce their dependence on coal. But still, these developed countries have also not reduced their dependence on coal. In fact, the UNFCCC, that is the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, UNFCCC has itself reported that between 1990 to 2017, the developed nations have been able to reduce their annual emissions by only 1.3%. And given that these such estimations, they involve, there will be some inevitable errors, just this reduction of 1.3% is, it's like it's almost nil. So this is the report of the UNFCCC itself, saying that between 1990 and 2017, the developed countries have been able to reduce their emissions, have been able to cut their emissions by only 1.3%, which is very, very less. So when the developed countries are the ones who are responsible for this, for the climate change and the greenhouse and the global warming, then why is it that the developing countries are being asked to reduce their emissions, cut their emissions by so much percentage in such a short span of time? This is the second issue. The third issue is related to the energy security. India, being a developing country, has a lot of needs which are to be fulfilled. So India's development requires its industrialization and modernization, all of which requires a lot of energy. India also has a huge population of over 1.3 billion, so which means energy security is of utmost importance to a developing country like India. So in this case, it is estimated that by 2030, the electricity consumption demand in India is going to be anywhere between 1580 to 1660 units per person per year. This is an estimation that by 2030, each person per year will need this many number of units of electricity. And if we estimate or extrapolate this demand to 2030, and this is the demand that has been estimated to be in 2030, then for that, the renewable energy generation will have to be anywhere between 650 gigawatts to 750 gigawatts. And this is a very huge amount of renewable energy, and we need to generate, which means from today itself, we need to generate a lot amount of our energy, which has to come from the renewable sector. Such a huge transition for a country is very, very difficult. So therefore, if we are really concerned about our energy security in India, for a developing country like India, then this is highly impossible, that given this will be the energy demand in 2030, which is very huge, we may have to increase our renewable energy potential to 650 to 750 gigawatts, which is extremely huge transition for a developing country. Because even such huge transitions also require a lot of investments in technology, the financial investments are required, which is very difficult for a developing country like India. And if we are foregoing our coal emissions, then it means we are compromising on our energy security. So therefore, this is the third issue, that if we are cutting down on our coal emissions so drastically, then we may have to compromise on our energy security, given such huge demands of energy that has been estimated to be in 2030. The last issue is the technological feasibility. So even if you are saying that if we can cut the coal emissions, for that we will have to increase the generation of renewable energy like solar energy, wind energy, etc. But is that technologically feasible? At this point of time, we also need to invest a lot in various technologies in these renewable energy sector. For example, if we just talk of the solar energy, in solar energy, we need to find out technologies which can increase the efficiency of conversion of the energy from its source into electricity. We also do not have any storage technologies. How are we going to store the energy that is generated from the solar cells? Where are we going to store that? So these storage technologies also, as of today, is not available with us. Thirdly, how are we going to ensure that the electricity grid is stable? So the grid stability, where the power from conventional sources and the power from the renewable sources are going to be integrated and they are going to be distributed seamlessly. So that grid stability, how are we going to ensure the integration of renewable energy? All of this requires a lot of technological improvements. And as of now, the technological feasibility is one big question. If we are really looking for a transition to the renewable energy so as to cut down the coal emissions, we will have to progress a lot on all these technological front. Before that, it is not possible for us to make a transition to renewable energy by cutting down on the coal emissions. So on this topic, you may face a question like, in order to fulfill India's commitments to the UNFCCC's Paris Agreement, we will have to reduce our dependence on coal in the future years to come. So, in such a scenario, what are all the challenges that India is going to face? So, in such cases, you can enumerate these challenges, and as these challenges, along with the discussion of the challenges, as we've also integrated data, good data related to it, so it will give you a full-fledged answer to such a question. Now, we'll move on to the next topic. The next topic we're going to discuss is the issue of Quad. So, Quad, as you all know, is an initiative that is proposed by four democratic countries of India, United States, Australia, and Japan in order to have free and open Indo-Pacific and in order to increase the presence in the Indo-Pacific. And the main objective was of forming this Quad by the four countries was to just counter China in the Indo-Pacific region. So, this was the primary objective of Quad. So, on this issue, there has been a lot of discussion and hot debates that is going on whether India should actually form this Quad and collaborate with the other countries in the region to counter China in the region, to counter the aggressive and the muscular approach of China. So, what is the utility of Quad? Is that going to achieve this objective of countering the China or not? So definitely, as Quad is a very important topic that has been in news, you may get a direct question on Quad as part of your GS2 syllabus in your international relations. Whether Quad, which is being now seen with the prism of China, that Quad is something that can counter China in the maritime domain, is that going to be successful? What are the costs and benefits for India? So in that case, when we talk of the utility of Quad, the first thing that India has to realize is the challenge that India has with China is across the continental border. So it is in the continental domain, but what Quad is talking about is the Indo-Pacific, which is a maritime domain. And the two are completely different. So even if the Quad is helping India to deal with the maritime domain and improve sort of the capabilities in the region, but India will have to deal with an aggressive China on the continental domain on its own. For that, no country is going to come to rescue India, and India will have to build its own capability to deal with the continental domain. So we have to take this Quad with by understanding that it has some inherent limitations, that it is going to be limited only to the maritime domain, and in the continental domain, India will have to tackle China on its own by improving its own capacities. The second thing is, at most, what Quad can do for India is to maybe provide some intelligence inputs, or if India has at some point of a time had any issues with China where it leads to some war or anything, maybe these countries can provide military hardware. But apart from all these things, Quad can do very less to India in dealing with China. So, at most, these countries will be able to provide intelligence inputs and military hardware, but more than that, there is nothing much that the Quad countries can do to help India when India is dealing with China in the continental domain. So, these are the limitations of Quad. But at the same time, this article also argues that Quad, we need to see it as an initiative of the four countries where the collaboration should not necessarily be limited to the military domain. It is not just the Quad is not an initiative of four countries coming together and they are collaborating, not just in a military sense, but also for various other purposes. So today you have so many other areas where, for example, these countries could come together and they can provide an alternative to the Belt and Road Initiative. So they can come together, pool their resources, they can come out with a plan which is an alternative to the Belt and Road Initiative. Also, China is becoming a global leader in the 5G technologies. Now, these countries can collaborate and they can also increase their cooperation in as far as 5G technology is concerned. Similarly, in cyberspace and artificial intelligence, these countries can cooperate with each other. And also, looking at the state the world is today because of the COVID-19 pandemic, these countries can come together and also discuss how the post-COVID-19 world is going to be, and in such a scenario, what will be the healthcare model in the future. So, these discussions can also be done by the four countries coming together. And in the post-COVID-19 world, where countries are looking to reduce their dependence on China, which has a very strong supply chain links with the rest of the global economy. These four countries can come together and also deliberate on how the supply chain resiliency can be attained. So through this way, there can be a lot of cooperation, and they can talk about various areas where this interoperability can be there, and it might not be just limited to the military sense. So this way, we can make use of Quad, and also in Quad include other like-minded countries which may share the same vision as these four countries, and also broaden the vision of Quad to not just be limited to the military sense, but also to include various other fields. So that could be really helpful for India. So this was the gist of this article. Now we'll move on to the next topic. The next topic we'll be discussing is about the animal ethics. So animal rights, animal ethics is a good part of your GS4 syllabus. So you have to know how you can formulate your opinion on some of the issues that is related to animal welfare, animal rights, and animal ethics. So in this article, it is about an analysis of the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. So there are various issues in this act which have been pointed out in this article. It is good to be aware of these issues whenever you have to formulate your own opinion in case studies or otherwise in the part A questions of your ethics paper. You will have some good points ready with you, some fodder points ready with you to construct your argument in the answer. So that is why this article is very important. So let's get into the issues. So first thing is that the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, the main purpose of this act, as the act itself says, is to prevent cruelty against animals. But let's say the provisions of the act is violated and violence is meted out to animals. So in such a case, the act provides a very small fine amount of just rupees 50. For any kind of violence, even if it is severe, you do on the animals, it has a paltry fine of just rupees 50. So therefore, nobody will really bother about committing any violence against the animals, because even if they are caught, at the end of the day, they will just have to pay rupees 50. So this is one issue. Second is, there is no grading of offenses. Section 11 of this act lists out the various offenses, be it like just abandoning your pet animal, or kicking your animal, or even killing the animal. But whatever be the offense, the majority of the offenses have the same punishment. So no matter whether the violence of this act, whether the offense is less serious or moderately serious or more serious, but the punishment for these different types of offense is the same. So that is, all the offenses are treated on a par, and there is no differentiation between an offense which is less severe and that is more severe. So therefore, there has to be a gradation of offenses where the more severe offenses are treated with more stringent punishment than the less severe offenses. This is the second issue. The third is that there is a plethora of exceptions in this act. So the act at the outset says that we need to prevent cruelty against animals, but it carves out a lot of exceptions. For example, for the purpose of the animal husbandry practices, if you are carrying out animal husbandry practices, then you may even dehorn the animal, you may nose rope the animal, you can brand the animal and castrate the animal. All of these things, which would have otherwise been very cruel on the animal, have been carved out as exceptions. If you're carrying out an animal husbandry business, you will have to do all these things, and all these things have then been exempted under this particular act. But however, these are those processes which create a lot of stress on the animals, both emotional, that is psychological, as well as physical. So it amounts to a lot of cruelty on the animal. For example, when the farmer wants to dehorn the cattle, then they will use hot irons, knives, and wires, which is very painful to the cattle. Similarly, while putting the nose rope, then the nose of the animal will have to be pierced with very thick, blunt needle, which again leads to a lot of bleeding, and it amounts to cruelty against animals. Similarly, the animals have to be put they will have to be given some identity marks so that the animals can be identified. For that, usually hot iron is directly planted on the animal skin to imprint that identification mark, which is again extremely cruel. But all these activities are exempted under this act, which they don't attract the provisions related to the violation, that is cruelty on animals and therefore punishment. All these provisions doesn't apply to these, because they come under the animal husbandry practices. So therefore, like that, there are a lot of exceptions. So using these exceptions, a lot of cruelty is done on the animals and they never attract the provisions of this law. The next issue is that some of the provisions of this act are also very ambiguous. For example, this act says that the main objective of this act is to prevent the infliction of unnecessary pain or suffering on the animal. But the entire act does not say what is unnecessary. It doesn't define this term unnecessary. So when this unnecessary is very subjective, one judge may interpret it in a different way and another judge may interpret it in a different way. What is unnecessary for one judge may become necessary for another judge. So therefore, we must have proper, precise expression, an objective expression of what this unnecessary pain or suffering is. So these are the four important issues related to this act, which you can use as fodder when you're making a case or arguing, putting your arguments and structuring your answer in the case of any question on animal rights and animal welfare. So what is a way forward? First is, if you are trying to, you know, nose rope the animals or dehorn the animals, at least provide anesthesia to the animals so that they don't feel the pain. This is the least one can do. Instead of hot irons being marked on their bodies, we can have radio frequency identities in order to identify the animal. We can make use of technology rather than torturing the animal. Similarly, those farmers who want to dehorn their cattle, we can encourage them to breed only hornless cattle. There are a lot of breeds of hornless cattle. They can breed the same rather than dehorning a horned cattle. And ultimately, we have to understand that all this is in the spirit of the Constitution. Our Constitution in the fundamental duties tells us that we all have to have compassion for living creatures. So this a spirit of compassion and empathy towards the animals should be there, and that lies in the spirit of the Constitution. So this is about this issue. Now we'll move on to the next topic. This is the last topic, which is the issue that is related to liberty. This is a part of your GS4, that is ethics paper again, because it talks about the ethics that is related to a vulnerable section of the population. So this is about the section 377 of the IPC, which was homosexuality, which was earlier criminal, was now decriminalized by the Supreme Court a couple of years before. So one little homework for you is you will have to tell in the comment section what was the name of the judgment that decriminalized homosexuality. So this is a small homework for you guys. And yes, so Supreme Court had decriminalized homosexuality and it has given recognition to the same-sex marriages. But now a PIL was filed in the Delhi High Court asking that now that homosexuality is decriminalized and same-sex marriages can happen, these same-sex marriages should be registered under the Hindu Marriage Act of 1955. This was a demand of the PIL. But now the Solicitor General of India has opposed this PIL, saying that same-sex marriages are against the society, are against the values and the legal system of India. So therefore, this can be used as an example in your ethics paper. In fact, some time back there was a question saying something which asked about those things which are legal but unethical and which are illegal but ethical. So you had to comment upon this. So here, this is a classic case where the section 377 has been struck off and the Supreme Court has decriminalized homosexuality, which means it is legal to have same-sex marriages. So it is already legal, but however, by denying them that rights to register their marriages, by denying them that basic dignity, and by denying them an equal treatment, it is actually an unethical behavior to do so. So here it is legal to offer them, to give them their rights and dignity, but however, it is unethical to deny them those basic rights and dignity, and to deny them the fact that they must be treated equally, and that is being denied to them. This whole thing is very unethical. So this example you can use in your GS4 syllabus to argue that this is an example of a case where it is legal to do something, but however, it has been argued that it cannot be done because it is against the society and the values. And who after all shapes the society and the values? It is us. So in fact, this article also argues that a couple of decades and years before, even women could not inherit the property of the father, but now she can. So there have been several changes that have been introduced in the society, and these value systems have been changing. So women who did not have the right to inherit the father's property, if today can have the right, similarly the society has evolved and something that was considered criminal is now being decriminalized and homosexual marriages is completely legal, then by saying that it is against the society and values and by denying them that right to dignity and right to equality is actually unethical. So this is can be used as an example in your GS4 paper when you are talking about unethical behavior or unethical principles. So these are the other topics that were not really important from your exam point of view or something that we have already discussed before. So that is it for today. Thank you.